Allahu Allah, Allahu 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 Allah, faqal rusula wa ula ahda subula lidalalatihi. Allahu Allahu Allah.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Wa ma arsalnaka illa kaffatan lin-nasi bashiran wa naziran walakinna aktharan nasi la ya'lamun. Sadaqallah. Sadaqallahul azim. My dear brethren, my dear brothers and sisters, this comes like an anti-climax to what we have been hearing, the voice from heaven. We hear Allah's kalam so beautifully read, and now comes along somebody like me wanting to speak and give some comments on some Quranic verses. To me, I feel, you feel ashamed to stand up after what you have been just hearing from Allah's kalam. But it's the love and feeling that you have for me, that you want to hear me talk as a brother Muslim, so I'm forced to say some words. It was towards his last days on earth, our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was in Medina. The whole of Arabia was at his feet. The whole of Arabia had accepted Islam. The only thing that was left to be done was now polishing up the Muslims, making them better Muslims, that he could sit back and relax. The job is done. Not so. This is what he must have felt, well-deserved rest. Leave it to the Sahabas to carry on polishing up the people, make them better Muslims. Not so. Allah Bari Ta'ala, he sends Akhi Jibreel with this ayah I read to you just now, telling him, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَّةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَزِيرًا وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. That we have not sent you, O Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, except as a giver of glad tidings, bashiran, wa naziran, and as a warner. وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. But the bulk of mankind, they still do not know. There's no time for rest. As the Urdu poet says, وقت فرصت ہے کہاں کام ابھی باقی ہے نور توحید کا اتمام ابھی باقی ہے. There's no time for rest and relaxation. There's work to be done. So what does he do? He calls the scribes, people who could read and write, because our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam was an ummi, an unlettered prophet. So he calls the scribes and he dictates to them five letters. One to the emperor of Persia, to the emperor at Constantinople, the king of Egypt, the king of Yemen, and the Negus of Abyssinia. Five letters on parchment, skins of animals, they were written down, short letters. Five sahabas, invaluable lives, five steed, horses, the Mercedes Benzes and the BMW of the time. That's what it was. And he sends them out in different directions, 1500 miles this way, 1000 miles the other way, across the Red Sea, few hundred miles behind him. This is what he did. Immediately he set in motion that the message that Allah had given him was not only for the Arabs. It was to be given to the rest of mankind. He said, وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. But the bulk of mankind still hasn't received the message. This is what he did. What he could afford. He can ill afford the lives of five sahabas, five horses with little parchments. I am asking our brethren, that if he had our petrodollars, and if he had the printing presses that we have at our disposal, pressing of the button and thousands and tens of thousands of Qurans can be churned out, would he not have flooded the world with the Quran, I ask you? If he can send out letters just with two verses of the Quran, one of these letters is collecting dust in the Topkapi Museum in Istanbul. Our Turkish brethren outwardly have looked after that parchment very well. I've seen it. It's protected. But the message is collecting dust. Because that letter to Heraclius, the Emperor at Constantinople, begins with the first ayah, the first verse of the Quran, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. And it continues. Generally, we can't read that letter because it is more like scratches, shorthand. The writings of 1400 years ago. We are used to nice, bold handwriting. So they have produced for us in beautiful script, side by side, a transcript in Arabic of that letter. So if you read this, you can decipher that. Then I read it with Bismillah. Then it says, from Muhammad Rasulullah to Heraclius, the Emperor at Constantinople, accept Islam and be benefited. Then another ayah from the Holy Quran, قُلْ يَا أَحْلَ الْكِتَابِ تَعَالَوْا إِلَىٰ كَلِمَةٍ سَوَائِمْ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ أَلَّا نَعْبُدَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَلَا نُشْرِكَ بِهِ شَيْئًا وَلَا يَتَّخِذَ بَعْضُنَا بَعْضًا أَرْبَابًا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ فَإِنْ تَوَلَّوْا فَكُلُوا شَهَدُوا بِأَنَّا مُسْلِمُونَ. And he ends in it with his own words and his seal. That message is collecting dust in Istanbul. That message. What is the message? The message says, قُلْ, Allah tells him, and he is telling them, and through him is telling us all. Every Muslim is being told, قُلْ, tell them, يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ, O people of the book, O Jews and Christians, تَعَالَوْ, come, إِلَىٰ كَلِمَةٍ سَوَائِمْ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ, that we come to common terms, as between us and you. Let us get onto a common platform. And the terms and conditions of getting together, Allah says, Allah na'budu illallah, that we worship none but Allah. This is what you want to talk about. You want to have a dialogue? What dialogue? Our brethren have been having dialogues with the Christians. One Christian missionary said it is hogwash. This dialogue taking place between Muslims and Christians is hogwash. You know what's hogwash? When you wash the pig and the leftover water, that's what it is. And wallah, that's a Christian missionary says that. And I think I'm inclined to agree with him. Hogwash, bluffing the people. Dialogue, what dialogue? What dialogue are you talking about? Allah is telling you to have a dialogue with him. Then he's telling you what to talk about. Not the price of oil and the position of woman. Then all this you can talk in your spare time. You have nothing else to do, you talk. But Allah is telling us what to talk about. Number one is Allah na'budu illallah, that we worship none but Allah. Talk about that. This is Allah says, talk about this. So he said, no, we worship the same God. So with God. He said, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. So Allah says, tell him, وَلَا تَكُولُوا ثَلَاثَا, don't say Trinity, إِن تَهُوا خَيْرٍ لَكُمْ, this is, stop it, it'll be better for you. إِنَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَهُمْ وَاحِدٍ, for your Allah is one Allah, he's not three in one, he's not one in three. He's telling you what to talk about. But that letter, that message is collecting dust in Istanbul, and that message is collecting dust in our homes. Every Muslim home, I can't imagine a Muslim home without a Quran. I can't imagine it. You Muslim and you haven't got a Quran in your house, the Mashhaf at least, the Arabic Quran, you haven't got it in your home. You're a Muslim. Whether you're a Bangladeshi or a Pakistani, whatever you are a Sudanese, whatever you are, we have Qurans in our homes. The Quran is there, but the message is collecting dust. This is what hurts, is the message. Nobody ever uses that. Nobody. I've been to Egypt. With apologies to our sheikh from Egypt, please. I mean no personal hurt to anybody. I just come from Egypt. In March, I was there in Egypt. They called me to a Dawah conference. You know what's Dawah? Dawah means invitation. In Urdu, when you say Dawah, I say invite you for tea, Dawah. Invite you for Walima, they call it, you know, wedding feast. We call it Dawah. When we say Dawah conference, it means propagation, not coming to eat for a cup of tea. Yes, Dawah, the word Dawah we use. In my language, in Gujarati, we say Dawah, Dawat. In Urdu, we say Dawah, Dawat dete hain. This Dawah conference means propagation of Islam. They want to discuss the problems in Egypt. How best that we can do Dawah. And I was there for a week. Dawah, Dawah, Dawah. Really, not one word of Dawah. Big bluff, big bluff. Apologies, please. He's my host, you see. He speaks so nice about me and I'm speaking about his country. Not one word of Dawah. Wallah, not one. Husni Mubarak comes along. Handsome young man. I think he's one of the handsomest of Muslim rulers. Look, to me, he looks the handsomest. And his speech, he spoke beautiful Arabic. Although I can't understand Arabic as a language, beautiful. Wallah. No, Husn. Husn means beauty. No? Yes. Hussein, Hussein, Husn. It's all come from the same root word. You know, handsome, he's a handsome young man. And he started. He said, I'm listening, you know, among so many things. So, kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas, ta'muruna bil ma'roof wa tanhawna 'anil munkar wa tu'minuna billah. And he carried on. He didn't complete the ayah. Either intentionally or pressure. You know, since he was given maybe a certain time, he must just finish his talk in certain time. So he did, he read half the verse, ayah, and he carried on. And this is happening all the time. Not only with Husni Mubarak, with all the other Mubarak, saying people read half an ayah like the Christians do. The Christians do the same. They take a verse, half a verse, and they create a religion. He said, the soul that sinneth, it shall die. That's all. I said, look, that is only a phrase of a whole verse. Complete the verse. He doesn't know. The Muslim, he does the same. He ends, وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. What did he say? He says, kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas. He says, you are the best of people evolved for mankind. Ta'muruna bil ma'ruf wa tanhawna 'anil munkar. Because you enjoin what is right and you forbid what is wrong. That makes you the best of people. Wa tu'minuna billah, and you believe in Allah. That is only half the ayah. The other half, nobody reads it. Nobody expounds it. Where the solution to your problems are. He says, وَلَوْ آمَنَ أَهْلُ الْكِتَابِ لَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُمْ. But if the people of the book, meaning the Jews and the Christians, if they hearken to this message, it'll be better for them. In other words, it'll be better for you. مِنْهُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Among them there are good people. You believe that? I don't want to. But Allah says so. Among them, among the Jews. And among the Christians, Allah says, among them there are mu'mins, faithful people. وأكثرهم الفاسقون. But the majority of them are perverted transgressors. Yeah, here are your customers. The first people with whom we ought to share our deen. So our Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam sent the message with this ayah in it. In our homes, it's collecting dust like it's collecting dust in the Topkapi Museum. And there is no likelihood of it ever coming out from that dust. This is my experience in Egypt. One of the leading Muslim nations in the world. For 1400 years, Islam has been supreme in that country. 1400 years. From almost the very beginnings up to today. Except for a few years, the French came there. For a few years, the British came there. But overall, the Muslim is overlord of Egypt for 1400 years. Can you deny that? But where's the Dawah? The Christians are there. They're boasting there are 10 million Christians. They say there are 20 million. The Christians are boasting that there are 20 million Coptic Christians in Egypt. The Muslims say, no, there are only 10 million. I say, it's worse. If it's 10 million, it's worse. Because the 10 million has got you under such control. If 20 million had you, I might sympathize a little with you. But the 10 million, what they're doing to you, what they have done to you, absolutely emasculated you. castrated you like oxen, bell, bell, bana diye sabko. I go to the Dawah conference. I am promised that visa will be waiting for me when I arrive there. Mr. Didat, you don't have anything to worry about. I said, look, I'm a South African. You know, people, they don't like me because of my passport. It's not my fault. What can I do? He said, no, you have nothing to worry about. We'll have visas waiting for you. So I land in Cairo, Al-Qahira. And the man from the Al-Azhar, he comes and takes me from the aeroplane. Quick, 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 there are people there before me in the queue. He leaves that queue one side and he takes me right to the front, to the counter. So I'm getting VIP treatment. And I stand there waiting. He takes my passport and my son's passport and he goes. And I'm waiting, waiting, waiting. The queue is getting smaller and smaller. Eventually the queue is finished, but I'm still there. I was the VIP. Then he tells me, right, you sit down, Mr. Didat, you wait. I said, all right, I sit down, wait. He comes after another half an hour, I said, look, here is a lady here, she will now attend to you. I said, shukran. So she goes, and she comes back. She said, look, wait for half an hour. I said, I'll wait for an hour, wait for two. I have nothing else to do now. So she comes after an hour, he says, $40. I said, for what? He says, visas. I'm a guest of the government. He says, $40, 20 for your son, 20 for you. So I paid her $40. I gave her, she went and paid. Now, this was an Egyptian lady. Well-dressed, well-spoken, good English, but from her tongue I can make out that she is Egyptian. Means Arab. You know, the Arab accent is there. So when everything is done, I'm asking her in my own funny Arabic. I say, "My ismuki?" I hope I'm not murdering the language. "My ismuki? What is your name?" So she gives me a name which I can't remember. You see, something I never heard in my life before. See, the human mind, you need something to lean on, to pigeonhole with. You can't just, something from thin air, you hear something, it can't be retained. You have to pigeonhole somewhere. There's no pigeonhole for that word she told me. Then I'm asking her, "Anta Muslima?" She says, "No, I'm a Christian." So I'm telling her, I says, you know, Jesus Christ, before he parted, look, this is means our customer. A Muslim must be looking for opportunity for delivering the message. Anybody, everybody, anytime, every time. That's our primary duty. The primary duty of the Muslim is to deliver the message. Look for an excuse. And if you are looking for an opportunity, before one can say Jack Robbins, you got it. If that is what you want to do. You want to deliver the message? In so many innocent ways you can get going. So I said, you know, Jesus Christ, before he parted, he said, knowing she is an Egyptian Christian woman, I quoted her from the Arabic Bible, which I had taken a little trouble to learn. So, "Lakinni akulu lakumul haqqu, innahu khairul lakum. In antalika, li'allahu illa mantalik, la yatikumul mu'azzi, walakin in zahabtu ursilhu ilaykum." I didn't translate it for her, because she understood what I said. She was an Egyptian Christian lady. She understood. But for the benefit of my brethren who don't know Arabic, what I said was from the Gospel of St. John in the Christian Bible, chapter 16, verse 7, where it says, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth," Jesus says, "it is expedient for you, it is better for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I go, I will send him." That is what I told her in Arabic. So I'm asking her, who is this Mu'azzi? She says, "I don't know." So I said, you see, in the Holy Quran we are told that before he parted, Jesus, before he parted, he said, "وَمُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولٍ يَأْتِي مِنْ بَعْدِ اسْمُهُ أَحْمَدٍ," and giving glad tidings of a messenger to come after me whose name shall be Ahmad, which is another name for Muhammad, and Muhammad is Mu'azzi. She says, funny, these Egyptians, meaning the Muslims, the Muslim Egyptians. He said, these Egyptians, they take us to the dance, they take us to the cinema, but nobody tells us about Mu'azzi. Look, before I can get out of the airport, she gives me a sledgehammer to beat my brethren. So as soon as I meet them, the elite, the educated class, in the hotels, five-star hotel. I said, "Akhi, look, I just met a lady, Egyptian lady, and this is what she told me. Is it true?" So he said, "Yes." I meet another guy. I said, look, an Egyptian lady told me this at the airport. Is it true? He said, yes. You take them to the cinema, you take them to the dance, but you don't tell them anything about deen. Amazing. 1,400 years, you have not made even a scratch on the Christian community. Not even a scratch. We Muslims are there from then. And their children and their children's children, we are there. That was Muslim, what you are. 40 million, what 40 million? These 40 million are there. The children of the old Muslims that are there. Your procreation, you know. That's what you are, 40 million, if you are 40 million. The 10 million are the children of those that were there. For 1,400 years, they have been immune to any change. You have not been able to make even a scratch. Why? So I'm asking my Egyptian brethren in Egypt. I said, Ya Akhi, you read the Quran? He said, yes. In Arabic? He said, yes. You understand? He said, of course. He understands the Quran in Arabic. Yes, he understands. Unlike my people, we non-Arabs, we read for sawab, blessings. You know that? And I believe we will get the blessings. You know what we go through in Ramadan, Taraweeh? The longest prayer of the day, Isha. Then after that, followed by two Nafil Sunnah. Then we do 20 Taraweeh. Then we do 3 Witr. And then we do 2 again Nafil. Can you imagine? What an ordeal we are going through. More especially the non-Arab. He doesn't understand one word. You know that? Even if he's half the Quran, he's Qari in my country. Poor man, he doesn't understand a word, but he is going through the ordeal. And everybody, very disciplined. You know, if the non-Muslim sees, hey, fantastic people, these are angels all. No nation on earth can go through that discipline. No nation on earth, except the Muslim. But the poor man, not one word. If that fellow only knew that these guys, you know, 100% of them, they're going up and down, up and down, up and down, and they don't understand one word. It's a greater miracle still. Can you imagine this miracle? 100% of the people, they go through the whole month of Ramadan, me including myself, we go through the ordeal and don't understand one word. That's the position. But you Egyptians, I said, you understand? He said, yes. I said, Allah is telling you in your language. More directly addressed to you, addressed to all, but more directly to you because you understand the message. He says, Ya halal kitab, O people of the book, la taghlu fi dinikum. Say, do not go to extremes in your religion. Ya halal kitab, O Jews and Christians, do not go to extremes in your religion. Wala taqulu ala Allah illa al-haq. And don't say anything about Allah except the truth. Innama al-Masih, most certainly the Messiah, Isa ibn Maryama, Jesus the son of Mary, Rasulullah, is a messenger of Allah, wa kalimatuhu, and a word proceeding from him, al-qaha ila Maryamu wa ruhum minhu, which he bestowed upon Mary, and a word proceeding from him. Fa'aminu billahi wa rasulihi, so believe in Allah and his messenger. I said, did you tell them that? You Egyptians, I said, did you tell your Christian fellow countrymen this? He said, no. So Allah says in the Holy Quran, وَلَا تَكُولُوا ثَلَاثَا. Don't say Trinity. إِن تَهُوا خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. This is, stop it, it'll be better for you. إِنَّمَا اللَّهُ إِلَهُ وَاحِدٌ. For your Allah is one Allah. He's not three in one. He's not one in three. Did you tell them that? He says, no. So Allah says, لَكَدْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهُ هُوَ الْمَسِيحُ ابْنُ مَرْيَمُ. Anyone who says that Jesus Christ, the son of Mary, is God, is making kufr. It's an act of blasphemy, treason against Allah. وَقَالَ الْمَسِيحِ. But Christ said, Masih said, يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. O children of Israel, لَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ. Worship Allah, رَبِّي وَرَبُّكُمْ. Who is my Lord and your Lord. إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ. Whoever will associate anyone with Allah. فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلِيَ الْجَنَّةِ. Allah will make Jannat haram for them. Heaven will be forbidden for them. وَمَا وَهُمْ نَارٍ. And the fire of hell will be their dwelling place. وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارٍ. And for the wrongdoers there will be no one to help. I said, did you tell them that? He says, no. So Allah says, Ya Ahlul Kitab, O people of the book, Ta'alaw, come. Did you call them? He says, no. Wallah, they're telling me, no, no, no. I want to know why. What has happened to you? You read this in your own language and you know what Allah is telling you, and still in you, and you got numbers, power, everything there, and you can't even open your mouth. I want to know why. I want an explanation. That after 1,000, you have the Al-Azhar. I'm asking, do you have a course in the Al-Azhar where they teach you how to talk to the Christian, how to propagate the faith to those 10 million? He said, no, there's no such course. The awwal fard of the Muslim is to propagate the faith. And this is not a subject where they teach you, look, the Christian, how to talk to him. So they blame Sadat, the devil. They blame Husni Mubarak. I said, this guy was born yesterday, man. For 1,400 days you are there. I want to know, for what did you do for 1,400 years? Why do you blame him, Sadat and Mubarak? For 1,400 years there was no Sadat and no Mubarak. What are you doing then? You got the University of Al-Azhar for 1,000... the oldest university in the world. You mean to say in your university you are not dealing with the Quran, where Allah says wala takulu salasa, don't say Trinity? So the student says, look, we don't say Trinity. What is this? Allah wasting his time telling us don't say Trinity, we don't say Trinity. So no, there are people who say that the God the Father, God the Son and God the Holy Ghost. Who are they? It's our Coptic neighbors. They say that. We may have to go and tell them. You can't talk that in Al-Azhar? The alims, they can't talk in the masjids? For 1400 years, you couldn't? I say, I tell you why. You'll never be able to deliver the message till doomsday. I'm telling my Egyptian brothers, on their faces. I say, you can't deliver this message till doomsday. You know why? Because some basic rules you have not hearkened to. You haven't listened to basic rules, fundamental rules. Allah is giving you open secrets. Open secrets He's giving us how to do the job. He says, وَقَالُوا, and they say, the Jews and the Christians, they say, لَنْ يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَا هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارَى, that you Muslims will never enter Jannah. There is no heaven for you. There is no paradise for you. There is no salvation for you unless you become a Jew or unless you become a Christian. That's what they told the early Muslims. The Jew has fallen out of the race. He will be satisfied if you only recognize his right to our brother's land. The lands that have you said, if you say, look man, you can have it, he'll be happy with you, no problem. Because our battle is not a religious battle. We are not fighting the Jew because he's a Jew. Yahudi, kill him because he's a Yahudi. No. Battle is not racial, or he's a Jew, racially. For 1,000 years they lived in our midst, no problem. There had not been a single riot against the Jews in any Muslim land for 1,000 years. The problem started in 1918 with the Balfour Declaration and on increased. But prior to that, peace between the Muslims and the Jews for all times. An individual Muslim could have killed an individual Jew and a Jew could have killed a Muslim. But racially, as a people, the Jews didn't say kill the Muslims and the Muslims didn't say kill the Jews. The problem is Palestine. If you give them the rights to take our brother's land, they will be happy with you. They don't want to convert anybody. They have made the religion a racial religion. You have to be born a Jew to be a Jew. And if you fall in love with a Jewish girl, and if she is particular and you can't do without her, so she'll take you to the rabbi, go through a process that you'll have to learn Hebrew, you'll have to learn everything about this. And if you're not circumcised, like one white man said in South Africa, at the age of 23, he says, I was painfully circumcised and converted. But he's still a third grade Jew. You'll never become one equal to him. They don't want you. They don't want us. They only want political recognition. But the Christian is knocking at our doors. All over the world is knocking at our doors. If he can't knock at our doors in Saudi Arabia, he gets by radio. He gets by literature. He's getting through. Today, nobody is immune. Nobody anywhere in the world. You can't be immune. The radio waves are getting through to you. They get through to you. Through the press. Through the post, they're getting through to you. Or directly here in the UK, they knock at your doors. So far, I met only one man. He said, no, nobody knocks at his door. I said, you must be living in an ivory tower. Nobody knocks at your door. What kind of guy are you? Where are you living? They're knocking at our doors. So, say, لَنْ يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَ هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارًا. That you Muslims will never enter Jannat unless you become a Jew or you become a Christian. In answer to that, Allah says, تِلْكَ أَمَانِيُّهُمْ. That this is their wishful thinking, vain desires, hallucination. In Urdu, it's a bakwas. You know, this bleating baba, black sheep. This is just babbling. Don't get terrified with that. Don't be afraid of that. Qul, tell them, Hatu burhanakum, produce your proof, your burhan, in kuntum sadiqeen. If you are speaking the truth, let us have a look at your burhan, your certificate that entitles you to heaven and that destines us to hell. Let's have a look. I'm asking my Egyptian brethren in Egypt, did you ask them for the burhan? He says, no. There it is. Unless you ask for the burhan, you'll never be able to open your mouth. This is the secret. Allah is telling you, his burhan, ask him. Where's your proof? In other words, Allah knows that this is hocus pocus. This is all bunkum. Go to town with him, man. Get his proof. Without we asking, he's produced it. Here, I bought this from Birmingham, this Bible. This is a revised version of the Roman Catholic Bible. I paid £9.95 for this. 5 pence less than £10. This one here, this is another Bible. I paid £45 for this. £45 I paid for this. Don't get tickled with this cover. This is the Bible. I paid £45 for this. But they got the Bible in every 2,000 different languages. What language you want to read? Bangladeshi? Bengali? They got it. Urdu? They got it. Swahili? They got. What language you want to read? Gujarati? They got Urdu? What language you want to read? And for our Arab brethren, they got 11 different Arabic Bibles. No excuse. You see at the back of your mind, say, look, this Arab fellow, surely he'll go to hell. He's got no excuse. What dialect he wants, what script he wants. Palestinian, he's got it. Lahja. Palestinian lahja, he's got it. Syrian, he's got it. Moroccan, he's got it. Tunisian, he's got it. Egyptian and the Saudi, he's got it. What language, what dialect, what script? Man, they know how to catch fish. What are we doing? Nothing. Nothing, wallah, nothing. Collecting dust, that message is collecting dust. I say, my dear brother, it's about time. You took it out. Take that message out from the Quran. It was not meant for you or for me. وَلَا تَقُولُوا ثَلَاثًا. In the masjid, we hear it. At least in Ramadan, we heard it. Because the whole Quran was recited among them was, وَلَا تَقُولُوا ثَلَاثًا. In the Tarawih, didn't you hear? Anybody in your masjid say Salasa? They say Father, Son and Holy Ghost. You get Muslims coming here who believe in Salasa. Is there a Muslim who believes in 3 in 1 and 1 in 3? No. There isn't a Muslim. Is there a Muslim in the masjid who comes along and said that Jesus is God? No. Then who are you talking to? No. Allah is giving us that message. Find these people. Our Qari was reading so beautifully. So, وَقَالُوا اتَّخَذَ الرَّحْمَنُ وَلَدًا. And they say that Ar-Rahman, the merciful God, has begotten a son. Do you say that? No. In other words, these are instructions given to us. Find the people who are blaspheming against Allah. Talk to them. Win them. Bring them over. Reason with them. This is the awwal farz, the first duty of the Muslim. What's this? We have left that role. So we become targets. We become doormats for people. They come along and use us like doormats. They use us like punching bags. You see, when you do boxing, you do the punching bag, you know, for practice. Yes, they practice on us. They make nest in our heads. Is that the role Allah has for us? You being Muslim, we being Muslims, now this is the role Allah has in store for us. Become people's doormats and punching bags and nests. To mess in our heads. Is that the role? No, he says he's given you a deen. He said, liyuzahirahu ala deen kulli. The deen that is to master, overcome and supersede them all, kulli, bulldoze them all, kulli. Whether it be Hinduism, Buddhism, Christianism, Judaism, every ism, Islam is destined to master them all, overcome them all, bulldoze them all. Walau karihal mushrikun. He said, now my Muhammad, the mushrik might not like it. This is the destiny of his deen. Not being doormat for people. We are doormats. Punching bags. They practice on us. They make monkeys out of us, eat our food, drink our tea, and call our Nabi names. You know, insult Islam, insult the Quran. And we laugh. We laugh. It's a big joke. Allah, to Allah is no joke. Wallah, it's not joke to him. He says in Surah Maryam, وَقَالُوا اتَّخَذَ الرَّحْمَنُ وَلَدَا. And they say that Ar-Rahman, the merciful God, has begotten a son. سَلَّقَدْ جِئْتُمْ شَيْئًا عِدَّا. It's one of the most abominable assertions one can make. The worst swearing you can give Allah is this. You want to swear him? The worst swearing you can give is this. To say Allah begot a son. Because you're attributing to him an animal nature. The lower animal functions of sex. That's what you mean when he begot a son. سَلَّقَدْ جِئْتُمْ شَيْئًا عِدَّا. تَكَادُ السَّمَاوَاتُ يَتَفَتَّرْنَ مِنْهُ. At it, the skies are ready to burst. وَتَنْشَقَّ الْأَرْضُ. And the earth to split asunder. وَتَخِرُّ الْجِبَالُ حَدَّ. And the mountains to fall down in utter ruin. أَنْدَ أَوْلِ الرَّحْمَنِ وَلَدَى. That they should say that Ar-Rahman, the merciful God, has begotten a son. Such a horrible swearing, Allah says, that if the heavens had emotions and feelings like you, O Muslims, the heaven would have fallen down. If they had feelings like you, if they had emotion, the earth would have split asunder and the mountains would have fallen down in utter ruin. If they had feelings and emotions like you, what has happened to you? We say we love Allah more than anything else. We love Allah more than our wives and our daughters and our mothers. That's our claim. When you go home and your wife tells you or your mother tells you, you say, you know this neighbor, he was swearing me like this. You know, he called me all sorts of names. You can eat. You'll eat in peace? You sleep in peace? No. You react. You want to silence a man for good. And if you can't do it, you'll hire a gang. No man cost me £1,000. Silence him for good. No? That's how much you love. We love our wives, our daughters, our sisters, our mothers. But we say we love Allah more than anything else. And they're saying that Allah has begotten a son. Allah reacts. But nothing happens to the Muslim. Nothing anywhere in the world. Nothing anywhere. I want to know what hypocrites we are. What are you? Hypocrites. You mean to say you can't get moved? If your wife tells you, your daughter tells you, your sister tells you that guy was swearing me, you get upset. You want to kill. But when they swear Allah, it's a big joke. Do you know that? Big joke to the Muslim all over the world. Whether you are in Pakistan, you are the same. Whether in Saudi Arabia or UAE, wherever you are, in England, you are the same. Big joke. This is our choice. We have chosen this. So, I said, the fundamental thing is that if you do not learn this technique, how to burhanakum, you can't do the job. Occasionally, we'll get brothers, Muslims. People come by, there's visitors. They say, these people are good people, man, on a Sunday, what are they doing? And weekday, anytime, in my masjid in Durban, Zohar time, 1,000 people. In the middle of the day, middle of the week, 1,000 people in the masjid, in the center of the town. They can't believe it. I said, don't you people have work to do? Don't you do anything for living? I said, yes. We work as hard as you and even harder. Because of our color, we have to work harder than the white man. But they can't understand. Fantastic people. We are a fantastic people. Wallah, we are. But occasional convert we get. The guy gets fascinated with your good way, this thing, that thing, he becomes a Muslim. But as a people as a whole, they are immunized against Islam. They will not, as a people as a whole, you have to learn now techniques of getting to his heart and mind and his mentality. He is a one book professor. He only knows about one book, the Bible, the Bible, the Bible. So you have to use his book, his Burhan, to talk to him, to reason with him. Unless you do that, hopeless. As a people, individually, we will get. A lady falls in love with a Muslim young man and, you know, comes before the Shaykh and says, man, convert her. You'll get them by the hundreds. But as a people, to talk to them as a people, you can't talk, you can't open your mouth unless you perfect yourself, you know something about his Burhan. That's a secret. Now, number one, you see, we have to arm ourselves. First is with our own holy book. We need the Quran. Every Muslim has a Quran in the house. I take it. Some Urdu-speaking people, they have Urdu translation as well. The Bengali brother will have a Bengali translation as well. Some Gujarati fellow will have a Gujarati translation as well. The Arab, he says he doesn't need it. He thinks he doesn't need it. Because he understands. Like our beloved Qari, does he need a translation? No. No, he apprehends the message direct. There is no better way than that. But in this environment, each and every Muslim home, you need an English translation. This environment forces you to have that. Because you for yourself may be very knowledgeable about the Quran. You understand beautifully the message in your own language, in Arabic. But that, how are you going to reproduce for the other man? You need the right terminology. You understand, for you, between you and Allah, no problem whatsoever. But now as soon as you start talking to the other, he says, you know, we believe in Jesus. I say, yes. You believe in Jesus? Yes. So you know what the Quran says? He says, no. So you know a little bit, so you tell him. He says, Bismillahir Rahman Rahim. Wa is qalatil malaikatu ya Maryamu. So behold, the angel said, wa is qalatil malaikatu ya Maryamu. So what's that? He said, you see, the angels, they told Mary, you see, the mother of Jesus. Inna Allah istafaki wa taharaki wa istafaki ala nisa'il alameen. That God Almighty, you know, He likes you very much and He selects you and better than all other women in the world. This is what you're going to do. For yourself, you understood it beautifully. But how are you going to reproduce that message? You producing in your own broken way, you haven't got the mastery of the English language. Maybe as in you are a master of English in mathematics or in medicine or in law, but this is something different. So therefore, I say even the Arab needs a translation. So he can learn like a machine gun, staccato. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of God, most gracious, most merciful. Wa is qalatil malaikatu ya Maryamu. He learns the meaning. Behold, the angel said, O Mary, inna Allah astafaki wa taharaki wa astafaki ala nisa'il alameen. That God Almighty has chosen thee and purified thee, chosen thee above the women of all nations. Ya Maryamu qnuti li rabbiki wasjudi warkai marraqeen. O Mary, worship thy Lord devoutly. Prostrate thyself and bow down in prayer with those who bow down. Dhalika min ambail ghaibi nuhihi ilayka. This is part of the tidings of the things unseen, which we reveal unto thee, O Apostle, by inspiration. You have to learn it like that. For that you need it. Your children need it. It'll improve your English. Better construction of sentences, new vocabulary, all this. Blessings, blessings. And this Quran is available today, so cheap. Here. So cheap. This encyclopedia. 2,000 pages. I actually counted the pages. Actually 1,920. Not much less than 2,000. 2,000 pages. You know how much? £5. I showed you the Roman Catholic Bible. I paid £9.95. The other one is the King James Version, the old ancient version. I paid £45. 9 times the amount what you pay for this, I paid for that. 9 times. The other one, I paid twice the amount of what you pay for this. This 2,000 pages. An encyclopedia of Islam. £5. And they're available here for you in this country. The pamphlets are given out. This pamphlet here, before you go, most probably you'll get them, if there are enough there. It tells you here, read it! The most positive book in the world. The Quran, the most positive book in the world. A fountain of mercy and wisdom. A guide to the erring. And so on, beautiful. A solace to the suffering. A hope to those in despair. And free, free, free. To every school, college, university and public library, absolutely free of charge. every mosque and madrasa absolutely free of charge. Look, we are offering. Whatever Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam would have done, we are trying to do, wallah, without those petrodollars. We haven't got those petrodollar pipelines connected yet. But we are able to sweat, and we are giving this. Free to every school, college, university, and public library, free. Every mosque and madrasa, free. And to the general public, £5 each. We haven't got the same big market the Christians have, but £5 each. As if it is stolen property or insolvent, or liquidation stock. Stolen property. I said, look, what are you worried about? Brother, you get it. Take it. How we got it, what we do, you want me to explain? Don't waste my 10 minutes. I'm going to waste my 10 minutes telling you how I do it, how I manage it. Don't worry about that. It's yours. Then, I quoted you a verse. You know where it was from? From Surah Sabah. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَّةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَزِيرًا وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Where do you find it in the Quran? In this encyclopedia? Where? 2,000 pages. Where are you going to find this now? I said, go and check up, man. Check up. Anybody gives you any reference, go and check up at home. Not that you distrust the speaker, but for your own benefit. If you go and check it up, if you see it with your own eyes, and if you read it again, it'll become your property. Then you'll be able to share. And the more you share, the more knowledge you will get. I said, this is from Surah Sabah. Now, how do you find Surah Sabah in this book? How? Page through? 2,000 pages. Where will you find Sabah? Can anybody tell me? Yes. This one has an index. Unlike the Arabic Quran from childhood I was reading, no index, no contents. You just start reading from Surah Fatiha, Alif Lam Mim, and the whole Quran. We don't know. We were used to Yasin. We know where Yasin is. Because if somebody was dying, our fathers told us, they said, look, you read Yasin Sharif, and then the person's ruh, you know, departs in peace. So we were reading. Our granny is going, our mother is dying, anybody else dying, sit down with Yasin. So we knew where Yasin was. But Sabah, where are you going to find? So index. This one has a very comprehensive index. And the S, look for Sabah. It'll tell you chapter 38. I'm sorry, chapter 34. 34 is easy to find because every page is numbered. Then I said, verse number 28. 28 is easy to find. Go and read what Allah says. Like that, everything on your fingertips. You know, this beautiful encyclopedia, everything. What do you want to know? You want to know about marriage and the M. You want to know about divorce and the D. You want to know about heaven or hell and the H. What do you want to know? You want to know about Jesus and the J. Just open and the J. Visitors come to your house, non-Muslim, call them. What you wait for them? Call them. Your neighbors, call them for a cup of tea and your bhajas and samosas and your curry and rice. Wallah, you don't know what you can achieve with that. You don't know, it's worth, wallah, that your curry and rice can captivate and enslave people. People love our food, you know that? I'm speaking especially to the Pakistani and the Hindustani fellow. I don't know about the Arab food. It's not so, I don't know. The Lebanese cook very well, and I don't know about the Egyptians so much. But, look, generally, our food, compared to the insipid food of the Englishman, insipid, not tasteless. Only salt and pepper. You know, ours has got some kick in it. Give it to him, man. And you see how he falls for you, wallah. Then, before he passed, he said, look, you know, have you seen the Quran? He says, no. Say, have you got an English translation? He says, yes. Would you like to have a look at it? Nobody says, no. This is the nature of man. He says, no. You says, yes, have a look. Open the book. The birth of Jesus, Surah Ali Imran. Where is Imran? Chapter 3. In the index, you'll find Imran is 3. Ayah 42. Open it. Read it to him in Arabic. Allah's kalam has power. It moves people to ecstasy and tears. Even non-Muslims, Allah tells us in the Quran that whenever signs are rehearsed to them, those people who are sincere among them, it says tears well up in their eyes. I have seen it again and again. Non-Muslims. When Qari Abdul Sabad Abdul Basit, he came to South Africa, he was reading at the Juma Masjid Durban, and I had come a little late. I had dropped my family, and where I dropped my family, there was a French Catholic priest standing in the doorway. And there was a horn there, loudspeaker. And the Qari Abdul Samad Abdul Basit had already started reading. and I could see this man swaying in the doorway. Yes. Not understanding a word. He's swaying. As if, you know, he's a trance, he's in a trance. Allah's Quran can do that. Why don't you do something? Talk to him, read to him, explain to him. Look, you are all here, my dear brothers and sisters. Allah has sent you here for a purpose. Not to eat, drink and make merry. Have a good time. We are all having a good time. Compared to our people back home, wherever you come from, whether in Egypt, or whether in Pakistan or Bangladesh or India, wherever you come from, you are better off here than in your own motherlands. Otherwise, you won't be staying here. Economically, materially, you are better off. Even if you are unemployed, they give you the dole. Look, you are well off. I know one man bluffed me when I said, in my country, I offer 5 rands each. That's actually the old rate, £2.10 each. And I said, if you can't afford it, just write and tell me why I should give you one for nothing. I'll give it to you for nothing. So some of your brothers here, they came across that advert. They write to me. He says, look, I got 6 children and I'm unemployed. Please, can I have one free? Oh, I feel pity for the man, compassion for the man. I sent him one free from South Africa. Then when I came here, I discovered that the man who's got 6 children and a wife and unemployed, man, he's a king. You know, he can save money. Yes, he even saves money. When I'm going around, some brothers take me around and they take me home, give me tea and biscuits and all that, and time to eat, they give me food. I said, brother, what are you doing? He said, unemployed. You know, I feel the food hard to go down. Wallah, he's unemployed. I'm cruel to him, you know. Look what I'm doing to him, doing injustice to him. So he said, look, Mota, big brother, don't worry. He said, we're all right. You got no excuse. Wallah, you got no excuse. Financially, you got no excuse. £5. No excuse. So, get this book. Your English will improve. Your English. It's construction of sentences for the Arab. I'm telling you, so your English. I've told them in the Arab countries. You want to improve your English? Here. Everything is here. Allah's Kalam. You read. Sawab, sawab, sawab. Blessings. Construction of sentences. New vocabulary. Everything on your fingertips. My dear brother, I'm not trying to sell you this because I might get some commission. But look, get it. That address is given there. And I'm very, very grateful for this opportunity of coming and talking to you this afternoon. And if there are any questions, I know I might have said hard things, harsh things. See, this old man, he has come out that way, you see, in life. You know, I have been, from childhood, you see, I was very weak. Big in bones and all that, big, tall, but I was very weak. So I had to learn boxing. I learned judo. I learned karate. I did weightlifting. I did swimming. All this, what for? You know, because I was very weak. I just wanted to make up for it. So now it creates that type of mentality. You see, once you go through all these processes, then your mentality changes. I was timid, afraid of getting hurt. Now I says, no man, I think for every 2 you give me, I can give you 1 at least. So you see that mentality. So now my voice changes, my voice is like that, and my actions are like that. You don't find a 70-year-old man doing things like that and talking like this. You can't. This is because of all what I have been going through all my life. So you say, now this guy is getting hot under the collar. No, I don't get hot under the collar. This is me. What can I do? I can't squeak like a mouse. I can roar only. I'm made that way. So if I talk to you a bit loud, you know, I'm not trying to scold you or try to frighten you. This is my way. What can I do?